Welcome to Thursdays with Troy. As always, I'm Troy Lambert, mystery author, editor, super plotterer, and your host. Today, I'm excited to introduce you to L.A. Sartor, although we will call her Leslie because that's her real name. L.A. is her pen name. Leslie Ann Sartor has been writing for it seems like forever, but starting being serious about this craft a while ago. She's a best-selling multi-genre indie author and has learned that being a pantser is no longer an option. So we're definitely going to talk about that. And plotting hasn't taken away one ounce of her spontaneity in writing. I think this is really important for discovery writers to hear. So welcome, Leslie.
Thank you. I'm really excited to be here. I love to talk writing.
Yes, absolutely. Well, that means we have something in common right away.
Good.
Now, you say you're a reformed pantser, and as a reformed pantser myself, I just want to ask you, what led you to make that change?
Oh, there were a couple things. I needed to produce books faster. As an indie author, I have that ability, which is awesome. And I realized that I was rewriting my story to make the story work, and it was driving me crazy. And I was using things like Scapel from Literature and Latte, Scribner, yep. The Scribner folks, and it was great, but it wasn't very flexible, and it did give me timelines and points, but it wasn't what I needed to write faster, right. Put more books out.
Right, exactly. And of course, writing faster is always a big thing for indie authors, especially now. So was that change a gradual one, or did you just decide one day, I'm done and I'm going to plot things?
I really started writing scripts way back. That was my first professional, was writing scripts and contracted scripts. And I was using the three-act structure and still do. And so I found that I really needed to have a better point at every major point in the story. So that's what started me. And moving into those other things, what caught my attention with Plottr was that I was able to, and I played with it for a while before I bought it, I always do, but I was able to let it work the way my brain works. And to me, that was awesome. I wasn't fitting in anybody's mold but mine. And I was so intrigued with that. And so I decided that that's what I was going to use. And that's what I've been using since it came out. And I love it. Makes me faster and better.
That's awesome. Because we're actually going to look at your Plottr file. And I'm going to talk to you about that. Because you structure things in a very different way than perhaps many other people do. But it's a fantastic way of thinking. Now, but you do say that not being a discovery writer has not taken away the spontaneity in your writing. So tell us a little bit about that. Like, how do you still be spontaneous even when you've got a pretty solid plan?
Well, my plan are points. There are points in the story that I know I have to put in, and every genre has those. And so being able to have those points on the graph and being able to know that I'm aiming toward those very important points allows me to have that spontaneity from point to point. So
right.
I think every author that I know knows the end of their story. They may not know all the specifics and all the details, but they know the end. Plotting with a cozy mystery, it's even more important to know that. So I have found that this allows me to put in all of those very important bullet points. And sometimes there's a lot of them, and sometimes there aren't so many, but then I come back and I realize I have to add more, and I can in Plottr.
Right, exactly. So we're going to look at your Plottr file. And one of the reasons that I love this is because you kind of go backwards a little bit.
Actually, a lot backwards. Yeah,
a lot backwards. So you're using the three-act structure, but we start in this particular one with Act 3. Yep. And so let's talk through this about plotting backwards from the crime, because I think this is a really unique approach, but also a very important one for mysteries. So talk to us about this bullet point, particularly in plotting backwards from the crime.
I was plotting this out and a friend was helping me, and he was mentioning it to his wife one day. She said, well, why would she want to do this? My God, she's wanted to meet this person all of her life. Why would she kill him? I thought, Oh, I better know all of that. So, because you can't write the story unless you know why the killer is doing what they're doing. So you have to have the motive for the crime. And even more importantly, you have to have the trigger, whatever sets them off. Because it isn't normal for a woman to go out and kill an older man or older man to kill a younger person. So what is the trigger? And that's what I was missing. Had the motive, and the opportunity and means are very important because you can't build a story unless you know that your character can do this crime and has the means to do it and the opportunity to do it. So this all has to be developed at the end. I really am a GMC fanatic. I think GMC, goal, motivation, and conflict is really important for all of your main characters. But if they can't do the crime, you got to change that. If they're not strong enough, big enough, tall enough, smart enough, you have to change it. And then I developed the 5 P's for murder. It's not my plan. It's been out there for some time. There's passion and profit and psychosis and protection and panic. Which one is your murderer or the person who creates the crime going to do? You have to know that too. If you don't know that, you're just going to flounder around. And by putting all this in, you can start building your story. And this is where you want to start, is at the end, because that's where the crime happens.
Right. And I think you're absolutely right in that a lot of mystery writers know this kind of intuitively. We know what's going to happen at the end of the story. We know what the crime is. Mm-hmm. We know what the motive, the goal, motivation, conflict. And I think that's very good that you start this way and those 5 P's are very valuable. Now, talk to me about Act 2, or actually talk to me about the midpoint and the false ending, because I also find this is something that's it's often used in mystery fiction, but I think a lot of people don't understand it.
Well, the false ending leads to the black moment. And the false ending is where they think everything is, and this is in almost every story. This is not just in mysteries. This is just good storytelling. The false ending is where the character has been moving forward and finding all these things, and things begin to unravel for him or her. And at this point, they have unraveled pretty badly. What is my false ending? What is going to happen? It's generally something that is directly applied to your main character. It is an action that's taken against them, or it's an action they've created themselves to fail. Not intentionally, but something has happened.
We really do think this is the end, and then it's not. This is right. Where things turn around. And then the adding in suspects. Now, I like this part in Act 2, and this is in a lot of mystery type templates. Mm-hmm. But let's just talk through this really quick as far as what you're adding in as you add in suspects.
You're going to have suspects that are really obvious suspects. And sometimes they're so obvious that you're like, it couldn't possibly be them because it's so obvious. And then your reader's thinking, well, maybe it could be them because they're so obvious. So that's the balancing act that you have to make. All your suspects do not have to come in right away. You know, they shouldn't all be there. You're going to introduce more characters as your story goes along. You're going to have your main characters come in the first part. Your suspects are going to create problems for you, and they're going to be giving you false clues. They're going to be giving you good information, bad information. They may disappear. They may be part of the crime. They may be another victim of the crime. And so as you're adding in suspects, the stakes are also rising higher because you have more problems and more problems to solve.
And this is a lot of like why these things come in and why the red herrings come in and why we also always say, hey, we know the guy arrested in the first 20 minutes of Law and Order. We know you didn't do it. Now, I wanted stop here and talk to you about there's a difference between plot driven and character driven writers. And you to be that you've come up with a very neat and tidy plot here, but do the characters come first for you, or does the plot come first and then you hang the characters into the plot?
It's a very interesting question. I have recently discovered that I am a plot-driven writer. And I say recently because I always thought that I was a character-driven writer because I love writing my characters. But I actually really love building the plot and fitting my characters and molding my characters into the plot. Traditionally, romance, it's character driven. It should be character driven. You care about the romance. You care about these people getting together. Whatever happens is driving them apart, but it's the characters first. And in a mystery, the puzzle is the first thing that people really want, then hopefully they're falling in love with your characters. But you have to create the puzzle. So I believe that that is plot driven.
That is very much plot driven. And there are many cases where mysteries are plot driven. And we see this in long series, Jack Reacher, you know, many of the very famous detectives is very much the character is just kind of a constant. So we're going to click over to characters, though, and I'm going to have you tell me about your characters and how they molded to work with your plot.
This book has been a long time coming. I've been working on this, and then Plottr came along, and it just made it so much easier because I can do this kind of stuff with it. And I have created attributes that I think are important for me to know about my character. So Jenna Hart, using a noun adjective, she's a ferocious jeweler, but she really didn't want to be that way. That's not what she is. But this murder has caused her to find her inner self, or her GMC is developing. If you can scroll down, there's a lot more things that I have in here that you wouldn't think to put in for a character. You know, what's her expertise and motive to kill is it's in the attributes for other characters. But what are her secrets? I haven't developed her secrets yet. But it's important for me to know that she's grown up in Angelcroft. And so she has roots here. And having this in front of me allows me to constantly go back and make sure that I am on track with my character. And that's really important because I could just flip over. If I'm writing in Scrivener, I have a split screen. If I'm writing in whatever, I have a split screen. So Plotter's on one side and my novel's on the other.
Right. Absolutely. And I do that exactly the same way. And I like that you referred to the fact that you created attributes that are important to your story. So not everyone's attributes for their characters will be the same as we've seen by interviewing different writers and looking at them. And obviously your motive to kill will then come into play with things like the suspects,
right?
Where if they don't have a motive to kill, it's hard for them to be a suspect.
Well, and what's her expertise? How can she kill?
And, right. What's the method?
Right. And I've created in my character list on the left, I've created other, I think they're categories. I think that's what I put them under for supporting.
Yes. We see some supporting characters and then
other.
Yep. Here. We'll just click this way.
Yeah. There we go. That's way easy. Okay. So I have main and then I have adversary and sidekick. But the adversary can be also the person that is at the authority figure. And having those broken down with these character categories really helps me a lot. And that's one of the cool things that Plottr has been able to do is now we can expand this from just supporting in main.
Right. You can add all your own character categories.
Right.
And so I do helpful. The same thing, suspects, killers, so that I know when I click over what's going on. And I do the same thing with a split screen. It's extremely valuable to be able to look at the details of these characters, but often just to look at the category and say, okay, who is who and what's happening here?
Well, when you get deep into a story, you don't want to have to find another form someplace else to remind you. You may be getting off track a little bit. We know that happens, right? You're writing and you're deep into the story and all of a sudden you've veered one direction. That's weird. So you need to get back onto your story, and having this in front of you allows you to do this. And like for Derek Tripp, I've mentioned that he's enjoys life. He has a dry wit and he's modeled after Chris Pine's Captain Kirk because he's a hysterical character. So I can remember this very quickly by just looking at this. So it helps me write faster and tighter.
Right, exactly. Which is actually one of the whole points. Well, we're going to talk about one other thing on the timeline.
All right.
Because I want to talk about TRDs, because we have to talk about these when we talk about mystery.
I have to say, I think that TRDs is something that I've always done. And I put it on the timeline as a reminder that I need to do this, because that would be one of the things that I would go back and do. I would have to put those twists in later. And reminding myself on the timeline that it's there will make this faster. But a twist is something, and it's exactly what it says. It takes the reader in a new direction. Then you have to make sure that you follow that up and don't just leave it as a dead end. And having this on the timeline allows you to make sure you're continuing with it. A reversal would be, for instance, a suspect that all of a sudden turns out to be the good guy or a good guy. And danger has really two points to it. It has physical danger where your characters, not only your prime characters, but your secondary characters can have some danger. And you really want to heighten that, especially at that dark moment, that black moment. That's a really good point to add some super danger to your heroine or hero. And the emotional danger that can happen. And emotional danger is really interesting because characters, that's what attracts your readers. Your characters are not all non-emotional. So if you put emotional danger in there for your characters, then hopefully your readers are going to want to fall in love with these characters and read the next 20 books in the series.
It's really interesting to think about that because, you know, speaking of Star Trek, and Mr. Spock even didn't have an emotionless journey. No. We saw emotions within him.
And didn't you fall in love with Spock when he was emotional? Because it was a twist in his character. It was something that you loved about him. And you're just like, whoa, that was unexpected. I like that.
That was unexpected. That was different. And that, that was an an excellent twist. So that's an excellent point. If you have a character that seems not emotional, adding emotion, adding these TRDs is a great way to throw your reader and to also get them engaged with that character.
Right. So it's not just for your plot. It's also for your characters.
All right. Well, now we're going to switch gears just a little bit. And so we're going to talk about you write in multiple genres. You mentioned that you write in, I think, four distinct genres. So tell me about those genres and also tell me how this method that we've looked at today, how that translates to those genres.
Well, I write in romantic suspense. I write in pure romance. I write in a adventure series with lots of myths and relics and things like that that are fun. Indiana Jones meets Romancing the Stone type of thing.
There you
and
go.
Now my, I love that. And now my cozy mysteries. Any genre that you write in needs to have these elements. It doesn't really matter what genre you write in. However, I plot my romantic suspense differently than I plot my mysteries. And my I have not used Plottr for my adventure series because right now they're on hiatus because I'm working on the cozy mystery, but I cannot wait to use it because it's going to help me find all these relics and mysteries and fun facts that people are going to uncover. And I'll be able to put it into the plot, into the timeline. And notice that I do it differently. I have my chapters and things on the side and my not on the top.
Yes.
Because that doesn't work the way my brain works. I tried it and it didn't work. So I switched them and you can switch them easily.
Yeah. So actually we're going to go, I'm going to look at your, pop this up on the screen and we're going to look at your romantic suspense because even though it's different, it's the same way in that you're using the three act structure.
Right.
And then I did want to point out to readers that instead you have your three act structure up above.
Yeah.
And
that chapter
kind of
one.
Your plot lines.
Yeah. Oh no, that was a mistake. I don't know how that popped in there. Sorry.
Because sometimes actually at that point we can delete it, but also you can use that for, you know, a prologue or to set up your inciting event or something like that. But we'll just do this. This is what happens, guys, when you get an extra thing in there that you don't want. We just delete it. But notice that you come down and you have your chapters here. So all of these, the first ones are chapters that are in Act 1. Mm-hmm. And then the next ones are in Act 2. So this is a very different structure from the way, let's say, that other writers take the chapters across the top. Mm-hmm. Tell us what kind of inspired this idea.
To do it this way?
Yeah.
I think, honestly, that is my plot-driven writing that did that. But I think about the acts and what's going to happen in the acts more than I think about what's going to happen to the characters. So for me to have the act structure down at the high point and as a reminder, reminds me where I am to keep my story moving, to keep the flow happening. For me, it feels like this really is the way I want to look at the story for a romantic suspense.
Well, I think in part it comes out of your screenwriter.
Oh, absolutely.
Brain. You know, in screenwriting, you do act one, act two, act three, and then you break it into the various scenes. And so it actually makes a lot of sense. It's a very interesting way to approach things. Obviously, you're using different methods for different genres because romantic suspense, apparently you go forward more than you go backwards, the same as you do in mysteries. And that makes sense because it just seems it's not necessarily necessary to do that backwards if you're not working on a mystery. But what else do you want listeners to know about your writing process? Like, what other things are there that you do that could potentially be of value to them?
Well, I mentioned GMC, and I think GMC is really important. I think GMC is like one of the best things an author can do for their characters. Yep. Now, in Plottr, I write down in my acts up above, I write down kind of where I want the story to go with those points. I really do now develop the story. I start with the beginning in chapter one, and I have my days in there, and I look at my act one at the very top. So I have the hook and the establishing incident. I can make all my notes in there that I need to put forward. And then an act one break. Have I done this? And so I do the main plot first. I put that up there because that's my plotting point. And then I do my character beats. Notice they're second. Then I do the setup with the character beats and the complications so that they're all. And then I can start doing the romance beats. I usually add those later when right. I figure it, when I'm actually writing the story. And then the timeline. And then timeline for me is really crucial because I need to keep it in my mind that I am still on day one. And I, again, split screen. I don't have to worry about it. It's right there. I remember where I am and it's done. I have used Plottr pretty consistently since maybe the first part of May, later part of April. And the thing is that I've been developing these, they're almost like beat sheets. If you guys know what that term is in the screenwriting mm-hmm. world, as I've been able to develop this and not only develop it, but fine tune it to make it work for me, to make it work with my brain. And so character choices, you know, I have character choices on midpoint. What are they going to do? Good, bad. And then I go in there and I can list what they've done. And man, it's really fast that way because then I can write those character choices in the chapters.
Right, exactly. Well, what I'm going to show people really quick here too is when we talk about goal motivation characters, one of the things that I do is you can use a template when you set up your new character. And there's a goal motivation conflict one, an internal goal, internal motivation conflict. I think this is really important to every story, especially to cozy mysteries. But when you do that goal motivation conflict and you add those attributes to it, is I go in and just fill those out really quick for the character. And then I actually have a scene template where I go in and fill out the goal motivation and conflict within that scene. So that within that chapter, I know what that chapter's for and what that is about. Mm-hmm. And this is just, it's a really important and kind of a unique way to approach putting your characters together and putting them in those situations.
And it makes you write faster, right?
Yes. And it makes you write faster, which is one of the whole points that Leslie and I've been talking about all day, all through this whole thing today, is basically that writing faster makes a huge difference to your writer career in general. Absolutely. Okay. So really quick, we're going to go through a couple of the things. What other resources have helped you get where you are today?
Well, I learned my screenwriting from an amazing man, Robert Gosnell, who actually has a book out called The Blue Collar Screenwriter. He's really big in Hollywood. He did a lot of work for Disney. He worked under Gary Marshall and he mentored me and I am forever grateful for that. I use Literature and Lattes Windows 3 Scrivener, and that's helpful. And I have these tools now that I go to all the time. So it's Scrivener, it's Plottr, and a couple of my good books that I pull from to put in these. So I will keep adding to my Plottr, and I expect it to be my number one tool to go to because I'm pulling all this information and I'm not just talking because we're talking about Plottr, but all my friends will tell you I'm so excited about it, that it allows you to really solve so many problems ahead of time if you set it up and play with it. You have to play with it. You'll find out what works for you.
Yep, and exactly.
How lucky is that?
It works differently for everyone.
Absolutely.
And that's what makes it extremely valuable. And you can pull on those other resources that you've used before. Now, somebody said they couldn't see the screen we were sharing, so I'm going to share that again really quick. Okay, let's use this one. So now you can see the internal goal, internal motivation, internal conflict. And when you click on these starter templates, it will show you what you're going to add in there. Mm-hmm. If I choose this one and create a new character, what it does is it imports your regular attributes that you had already for this particular book, but it's simply at the bottom adds your internal goal, motivation, and conflict. Mm-hmm. And so this is one of the features I love about these character templates is you don't have to choose one or the other because it doesn't delete what your other attributes were. So you don't have to worry about that. Mm-hmm. Instead, it just allows you to add more information to your characters already. And of course, like I said, goal, motivation, conflict is one of my things that I am big on.
Your motivation drives your characters forward.
It absolutely drives the story forward. It drives your characters forward, and it helps the reader understand where you're going and what in the world is going on.
Right.
So, all right. Well, we're going to wrap things up by saying, where can people learn more about you?
Well, they can go to my website, which is lasartor.com, and I will have links to my YouTube channel and my blog there, as well as my books. And I love teaching. I love writing. I love talking about writing. I love teaching about writing. So it is, that's probably your best resources to go there. You can find everything right there. Right. So it's lasartor.com.
Exactly. That's where I went to learn more about it.
Thanks. Glad to hear it.
Yes. And there is a blog there as well that focuses on writing and writing things that you can click through to. There's some great information there.
Thank you.
All right. Before we move on to other things, we, of course, have the classic Thursdays with Troy question of the day, which is always a top secret surprise because we're trying to solve the world's problems by asking writers who, of course, know how to solve the world's problems, the answers to big questions. But this time, I'm going to ask you a writing-related question. So this is more related to solving writers' problems and solving the problems of the world. But I'd like to ask you which one of these two things you would prefer. Are you ready?
I am, I think.
Okay. You can have one of these two things. You can have either one huge bestseller or lots of books that sell well.
Oh, that is only so hard. One. Lots of books.
I didn't say it was fair.
No,
I said it was.
I want both. I want lots of bestsellers. Okay, no, I want lots of books that sell well. I don't care if I'm famous. I just want to have fun writing books.
Exactly. All right. Thank you. That is fantastic. I'm glad we got that answer for you. And everyone, thanks for joining us on Thursdays with Troy. We hope you enjoyed yourself and learned a lot. So thanks, everyone, for joining us. We appreciate it. And we'll see you next time.
Bye, guys.